guys are coming from the TOC?
Yes.
Okay. You're dressed appropriately, huh? Are there more people coming? You know? Probably? Okay. Probably no? Okay. Okay, yeah, let's get started. Although I don't want to close that door. Maybe you can leave it a little bit open. Okay, let's get started. So this is lecture 8 for 740, 640, and we're going to cover an exciting topic. We've been covering a lot of exciting topics, but this is going to be the memory system. In the last few lectures, John covered out-of-order execution and data flow techniques, which are actually used in almost all high-performance microprocessors today, and all high-performance microprocessors have the memory system also. And one of the places where out-of-order execution is really beneficial is it can enable the tolerance of long latency accesses to memory. But these are the reading assignments. You'll have these slides, so you can take a look at these. And if you actually been taking 740, you've done some of these readings for your reviews anyway. And this is a paper. This is a long paper. It's not a required assignment, but if you want to, a lot of the contents that I will cover in this lecture are detailed in this paper that talks about the research problems and opportunities in memory systems, especially the first part. And in the latter part of this lecture, we'll go into how the DRAM system is organized. And if you want to learn more about the DRAM organization operation basics, some sections of these papers actually provide very quick background on DRAM operation and refresh. That's hard to find in other places, in my opinion. DRAM microarchitecture is kind of a black box in many places. And at some point, if we get to it, we'll talk about simulating main memory also. And this is always a question when you do computer architecture. And if you're taking 640, you're actually doing some simulation-based assignments. If you're taking 740, your class project is based on some simulation, probably. But you can take a look at an open source DRAM simulator, which is the subject of this course. But before I start going into the organization of the memory system, let's talk about why main memory system is so important, especially today. And if you've sat through recitations for 740, this is going to be a little bit deja vu for you. But it's always good to see the same thing again. That enables you to think deeper into the topic, and maybe you can develop some ideas. But basically, we're going to talk about this thing that sits in the middle of processors and caches. And we're going to assume that you actually know about caches, since it's a graduate level course, and storage. You have a main memory system, right? It's a working storage. And it's a critical component of all computing systems that we design today. And this system is getting more difficult to design today, because it really needs to scale in many dimensions: technology, efficiency, cost, algorithms we use to manage it, and size, capacity, to maintain the performance growth and technology scaling benefits that we've been used to for a while. And this is another view of the main memory system, including the on-chip components. And if you look at this today, this is really a cartoonish picture, but you can actually look at real examples from chips. But there are two key points here. One is the red parts are the parts that are dedicated to computation. And everything else is really dedicated to communication and storage, which is part of the memory system. And even the red parts have part of the memory system inside it, the registers, L1 caches, right? So we're designing these chips, these systems, where most of the resources are really dedicated to data movement and storage, which is memory. And the second thing is, if you look at this, the red parts share the entire memory system. You have a lot of shared components in the memory system: shared caches, shared memory controllers, dot, dot, dot. So it's a big shared resource. One of the biggest shared resources, memory. So we need to somehow manage it across these different computation units. So let me give you an overview of why main memory is becoming increasingly important going forward. This will cover the memory-related lectures. So we'll have several lectures related to memory. On Wednesday, we'll talk about emerging memory technologies. So think about that when we talk about the state of the memory system. But there are some recent technology, architecture, and application trends that lead to some new requirements from the system and that exacerbate some old requirements also. And we'll talk about some of those requirements. And DRAM and memory controllers are becoming very difficult to design to satisfy all of these requirements. And they're unlikely to satisfy these requirements. And hopefully, I'll give you some evidence from the field. And when you go into the field, you'll actually realize that you will be working with these problems, regardless of whatever you're doing in computer architecture. And there are also some emerging non-volatile memory technologies, or emerging memory technologies that happen to be non-volatile, that enable some new opportunities. And we'll talk about that in the next lecture. So given that we need to somehow fix the issues we're having with DRAM today, and perhaps enable these emerging memory technologies. And some of you may have heard an announcement from Intel and Micron, right, on 3D XPoint. That's one of the emerging memory technologies that was recently announced. It's kind of a mystery technology because they don't tell you what it is exactly. They kind of market what it does. It's really fast, high capacity, low latency, low energy. Endurance is very good. So. But we can talk about it in the next lecture. It's actually there's a lot of good reason to believe that that could be phase change technology or phase change memory technology. But basically, we need to somehow look at the main memory system in a new way to fix the issues that are happening with DRAM, which we will talk about, and enable some of the emerging technology, which we will also talk about, while satisfying all of these requirements. So let me tell you why memory is becoming increasingly more important. And this is a single slide that talks about why. Basically, there's an increasing need for main memory capacity, bandwidth, and quality of service. You're taking that part, right? Okay. And energy and power is becoming a bigger system design concern. And DRAM technology scaling is becoming really difficult or ending. And we'll talk about each of these in a little bit more detail. Basically, why do we need more memory capacity, bandwidth, and quality of service, some kind of predictability from the memory system? Because we are putting more agents, more cores on the chip, or more accelerators, different types of cores on the chip, and they're demanding more. Applications are becoming increasingly intensive. Almost all interesting applications that you have today, you guys are living in a really nice time where data is a huge thing, right? That didn't always used to be the case. Today, we can actually generate data in many, many domains that really overwhelms the processing capability. And we want to consolidate more in systems. Basically, you want to put more machines, more virtual machines together that are sharing the memory. As a result, you need more capacity. Bandwidth and quality of service requirements. And this is one example, very quickly. This is actually data from a paper that was published by HP Labs and University of Michigan, ISCA 2009. It's a nice paper, actually. It talks about disaggregated memory. You're not responsible for that, but you can take a look at the paper. Basically, what they plotted is, at that point in time, core count is doubling approximately every 2 years, whereas DRAM DIMM capacity is doubling approximately every 3 years. And take the core with a grain of salt. Because if you think about the GPUs, cores are actually doubling very, very fast today, right? And in fact, GPUs are seeing the capacity gap and bandwidth gap very quickly. But if you look at this, if you actually do the calculations, memory capacity per core is expected to drop by 30% every 2 years. Now think about the implications of this on the software side. If you're a software programmer and if you expect more memory to become readily available to a thread that you're writing, then you're not getting it. Especially if you're consolidating, if you're utilizing your system well. As a result, you're not able to write software that is more that has more features, right? So that's a problem. And the second is, if you actually do the trends for memory bandwidth per core, they're much worse than this. Memory bandwidth is increasing by approximately 10% every year, whereas core count is doubling, according to this, every 2 years, right? So you're really, that's why memory is becoming increasingly important. We're really starving these cores, and we're not putting more capacity. So we have this bottleneck between the memory bus and the processors. The second trend, energy and power is a key system design concern. And if you're really interested in this, I'd recommend this paper by Charles Lafergy and others from IBM Research. Basically, they've shown that, this is an IEEE computer paper in 2003, they've shown that approximately 40 to 50% of the entire system energy in IBM's big iron servers is spent on the off-chip memory hierarchy. Now, this includes the off-chip interconnect, off-chip caches, off-chip DRAM, and off-chip storage. But that's a lot, approximately half of your power. And that's true, actually. Many studies have shown that memory consumes a huge power on this, on these cell phone systems also. And one problem, which we will talk about later today, hopefully, DRAM consumes power even when it's not used. DRAM is the memory technology that we use main memory today. And the third point, which is actually really interesting, which was not happening until recently, is DRAM technology scaling is becoming much more difficult. So what I mean by technology scaling, basically we relied on reducing the size of the DRAM circuit to get more capacity, basically higher density, lower cost, and reasonable energy in memory. As we reduced the size of it, all of these became available. But then now it's becoming difficult to get those benefits. Basically, ITRS, International Technology Roadmap of Semiconductors, has been projecting for a long time that it's difficult to scale DRAM below some X nanometers. And I like putting X over there because they change that number. And that's the nice thing about being in the field of technology, right? The manufacturers will push down that X as much as possible because that's their vested interest. But as X goes down to smaller numbers, it becomes much more difficult to actually maintain the characteristics. And we will see that actually. Does anybody know what X is today? Like what kind of memory sizes we have in terms of technology feature size? 24, you're close. Yeah? Yeah, you're close. It's about 20, actually. The cutting edge technology is around 20 nanometers today. And manufacturers are developing actually 1.8 or 18 nanometers around that. But it's come at a cost, actually. As you reduce X, you run into problems. And I'll tell you about those problems. Let me talk about this DRAM scaling problem, because it's very fundamental with any kind of memory technology. At some point, we'll talk about flash also, maybe in the emerging technologies lecture. But you've all taken some circuit course at some point, right? So you know this circuit, basically. This is the DRAM circuit. You need capacitor to store charge. And DRAM stores charge in this capacitor. Whether the capacitor is charged or discharged indicates a 0 or 1, right? And you need to access that charge. This is the access transistor. And you need to do a charge sharing across the bit line. And you need to have a sense amplifier to figure out whether the capacitor is actually a 1 or 0, right? To sense the perturbation of the charge in the bit line. Basically, this capacitor must be large enough for reliable sensing. And this access transistor must be large enough for low leakage and high retention time. And the problem with DRAM scaling is as you reduce the size of the circuit, both of these properties become difficult to maintain. Capacitor becomes less reliable as it becomes smaller. And access transistor becomes more leaky also, as well as less reliable, more prone to errors. And as a result, scaling beyond some X nanometers is challenging. And that was the value that was assigned to X by ITRS in 2009. They said that it's challenging to scale the circuit below 35 nanometers. And they were actually right. So I'll give you some evidence based on some of the research that's done in my group. But it's a popular thing right now. Basically, if you buy some DRAM chips in the field today, they're vulnerable to errors that were not exposed to the user before. And this is called the Rohrhammer phenomenon. Basically, if you want to access DRAM, you need to access an entire row. You apply high voltage to a word line. That's actually most of memory operates that way. We'll see that later on. But you apply high voltage to the word line. Basically, you activate the row. And then you can precharge the row, close the row. That's basically how you do the read and then close the row such that you access another row. Now, if you actually keep activating the same row over and over, activate, 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 precharge, activate, precharge, activate, precharge, this is what happens. You get errors in adjacent rows. Now, this is exactly what you would expect, right? No, of course not. You don't want that in memory, right? You don't want some other row. Just by reading a particular row in memory, you don't want some other unrelated data to get errors. This is not supposed to happen, right? But this is happening today in many DRAM chips. And I'll give you some results. You can take a look at this paper for more detail. It's not required reading. But basically, you can. This is called the hammered row. And these are the victim rows. And this happens because now, because the circuit is so small that now you have coupling across the word lines. Right? Once you activate a word line, you're really exerting the charge leakage on the capacitors or the access transistors that are connected to the other word line because the word lines are too close to each other. And this happens because you can do enough accesses within a refresh interval. So it's really a scaling problem. And this is one of the reasons why main memory is becoming even more important going forward. So let me give you some very quick results based on the experiments that we've done. Basically, these are tests that are done on memory modules from three major manufacturers. And more than 80% of them are vulnerable to this kind of errors. That's a bit scary. How many of you know how flash memory operates? No? Maybe we'll talk about that at some point. But this is actually a very fundamental problem with any type of memory. As you reduce the size of the charge storage unit or storage unit, it becomes less reliable. It becomes prone to these disturbance effects. So flash memory is very prone to these disturbance errors, for example. Hard disks, a totally different technology. They're also prone to these disturbance errors. Basically, when you read one track in a hard disk and you keep doing that repeatedly, in fact, you don't need to repeat it many, many times. In this case, you need to repeat it about 50,000 to 150,000 times. But in hard disk, you actually destroy parts of the adjacent track. That's called adjacent track interference in hard disks. The controller actually does error correction in the adjacent track such that that doesn't get exposed to the user. In DRAM, in main memory, it's a little bit different, right? Because with the main memory, we can directly access it in programs. You can do a load. An array gets allocated in main memory. Now you get the error very quickly because the controller, if the controller doesn't do correction. So let's take it a little bit up at the higher level. Basically, we can access main memory with loads and stores, which means that we can actually induce these errors at with a user-level program that looks like this. And you can actually download this program if you want. What this does is basically it keeps ping-ponging between two rows that map to the same bank. Keeps doing activate, 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 and as a result, cause errors. Make sense? You can actually try this out. That could be a fun assignment for you with that code. And eventually, basically, this gets exposed to the system, and the systems are vulnerable. So this is a real reliability and security issue which didn't exist in memory in the past. It's happening because memory is becoming much denser today. So why is this a scaling issue? Let's take a look at this graph over here. Basically, this is the modules. This is the vintage of the module that is tested from 2008 to 2014. This is the error rate that you get. Initially, the modules that were manufactured before 2010 are not vulnerable to this kind of errors. Later, the circuit scaled so small that, and the manufacturers were not able to capture this error mechanism somehow. As a result, you get errors, a lot of errors, in all of the modules that are manufactured between 2012 and 2013. That's why this is a scaling problem. And you can read some of these papers. I'm going to skip these. So if you're curious about how you can actually test this, you can actually build FPGA-based infrastructures that can actually test this memory. If you guys want to ever do projects, especially for 740 on this, I would definitely encourage you to do some projects, research projects with this infrastructure. So I'm going to skip this also. So if you have more interest in this, you can take a look at the paper. But let me cover very briefly the solution. Like, how can you solve this problem? Any thoughts? How can you prevent someone from hammering a row? Or how can you fix it? Anybody? Clearly, the manufacturers were not able to fix it. Maybe they didn't realize it. Come on. Yeah? That's right. So you can actually increase the refresh rate, for example. And as a result, you cannot do enough activates within a refresh interval to cause errors. And that was actually one of the solutions that are proposed. Apple actually released a security patch that increased the refresh rate on Apple systems. Or you can do error correction codes, right? That's actually one of the proposals that are coming out of manufacturers today because it's difficult for them to handle these scaling issues. In the past, error correction codes in DRAM was something that the manufacturers did not think of. Well, maybe they did think of it, but they didn't want because it's a lot of overhead, right? Because you're dedicating part of your chip area to error correction codes. And today, they're actually considering it. So there are many solutions that you can imagine. We're not going to go over that, but you can take a look at it. So let me give you one example of why this problem is actually even more important than what I've described so far. Basically, you can take advantage of these errors to take over an otherwise secure system. So if you read the paper that I mentioned early on, the first sentence says, memory isolation is a key property of a reliable and secure computing system, and access to one memory address should not have unintended side effects on data stored in other addresses. That's hopefully the foundations of a secure system, right? You don't want to modify another address unintentionally. And this paper talks about the possibility of building an attack by taking advantage of these errors. And later, Google Project Zero, and this is a really cool blog, actually. If you have interest in this, I would recommend taking a look at this blog. What they did was they exploited this little bug called the Rowhammer bug, let's say, to actually take over an entire system. And I'll very briefly tell you in this slide how they did it. But you'll have to take a look at that blog to see the details. Basically, what they did was they built two working privilege escalation exploits that take advantage of this Rowhammer bug. And they have a user-level program, unprivileged program, that keeps hammering a row and causing bit flips. And what they were able to do with that user-level program is to induce bit flips in the page table entries belonging to that program. And they were able to induce bit flips in the write enable bit of a page table entry that points to the page table of that program. If you can actually flip that bit from 0 to 1, now you have write enable access to your own page table, which means that you can actually modify the contents of your own page table, which means that you can have write enable access or any kind of access to the entire physical memory. So it's a pretty cool attack, actually. How do you do it? Of course, there is mechanics in Moldenitz, because this is kind of hacking. You need to hack to ensure that you get the right bits modified. But this is actually pretty cool. It's a nice attack, and they were able to gain access to entire physical memory in 50% of the laptops they've tested. So the seemingly small scaling problem can actually lead to a huge vulnerability, and you can actually see pictures of this. It's called the DRAM rope hammer vulnerability, and people have drawn pictures, weird pictures like this. But the seemingly small problem can lead to a huge security vulnerability. And one of the nicest analogies that I've read on the web about this is actually, if you want to gain access to that door over there in the far, you keep banging on this door. And because there's interference, disturbance caused by this, enough, if you bang enough times, you cause enough disturbance that that door props open. Yeah, so that's basically the gist of it. Right? It's always good to think about these cool analogies, right? Real life analogy. Okay, so let me recap. So the problem is real, and this is one of the reasons why memory is becoming extremely important. That's why we'll spend some time in memory. But let me recap the problem and talk about one thing that two manufacturers, Samsung and Intel, have written. This is a cool paper. It's very short. It's written by the DRAM design team by Samsung and DRAM and memory controller teams at Intel. And they basically say DRAM process scaling is becoming difficult. Refresh is a big problem. Retention is a big problem. Write latency is a big problem. And something called variable retention time, which I'm not going to discuss, is a big problem. If you have interest, you can go into more detail. But basically, it's difficult to solve these problems. So we need to somehow think about new solutions. Instead of just doing DRAM and controllers separately from each other, maybe we should design them together, co-architect them together, such that the controller covers the issues we're having with the circuit scaling at the DRAM side. If the DRAM is not scaling very well, maybe controller somehow corrects those errors, right? In a sense, this is very similar to what has happened in flash memory and hard disk, right? If you think about flash memory, SSDs, an SSD has its own controller, right? A hard disk has its own controller. There is a processor actually controlling the hard disk. Same with SSD. So DRAM may become like that going into the future. Controllers may become more intelligent. So maybe we'll talk about emerging technologies, and we may actually touch into some of these intelligent controllers, if you will, in the next lecture. But this is a nice paper if you would like to see an industry perspective on the problem. These are two unlikely partners to write a paper, by the way. Samsung and Intel don't go around writing papers and giving talks together. But this was a special case where they wrote paper together to point out the importance of the problem. OK, so how do we solve the problem? Let me give you some high-level solution directions just to get you thinking. And then we'll go into a little bit more detail later on. But one solution is fixing it, basically the previous paper that I mentioned proposes. Make DRAM and controllers more intelligent. Make them work together. Design new interfaces between them. Design new functions and maybe new architectures around it. And this is actually very interesting. I call this a system DRAM co-design. But going forward, you guys will be in a world where you may be required to think about things this way. Or the other solution direction, which we will examine in the next lecture, is eliminating or minimizing it. If we can somehow come up with a technology that doesn't have these issues, scaling issues, maybe phase change memory, maybe resistor RAM, memristors, for example, or maybe spin transfer torque MRAM, maybe we get rid of these problems, and maybe that technology is also non-volatile. This can enable a new technology that's completely different. It can enable a system-wide rethinking of memory and storage around it also. The third solution direction, this is again to jog your thinking a little bit, maybe we embrace the problem also, right? We say, oh, some memory is going to be unreliable. And if we want low costs, well, it's going to be unreliable. And on the other hand, there are some applications that can tolerate a lot of errors, like machine learning-based applications. They have their statistical iterative applications. So there's some noise tolerance in those applications. So if we can somehow figure out what parts of the application can tolerate the errors, maybe we can map that to these memories that are not that reliable, and we can enable the scaling of the entire system and the application together that way. Now, this is really interesting. This may lead to some new models for managing the data as we know it, and maybe new models of usage of computers, right? Normally, we think of DRAM as perfect memory, actually, right? You don't expect any errors in DRAM. Right? In fact, some of the errors, there was this cool study from Microsoft Research in 2001, It's called cycles, disks, and platters, something like that. I don't remember the exact. You can ask me later. But what they've done is they've analyzed the errors that they've seen in Windows, the blue screens, and they found that 10% of the blue screens are due to hardware errors. Maybe a bit flip happens in memory. As a result, you get a blue screen later on. Well, maybe that's going to increase going forward. I don't know if Microsoft still has blue screens. I don't use it that often, but you get the idea, right? Okay. So regardless of what we do, I think one key thing in the next lecture especially will be we'll need some more hardware, software, and device cooperation to solve the issues we're having with memory going forward. And you can see that in the Intel and Samsung paper that was written last year, right? They argue for co-architecting memory controllers and memory. Okay. So let me talk about some issues with DRAM very quickly. Like, what are the things that are becoming difficult? I'm not going to spend a lot of time over here, but reliability is becoming a problem with scaling. Energy is becoming a problem. And you can think of these as two sides of the same coin. Like, reliability, think about the Rohhammer problem. That's a reliability problem, right? You can expend more energy to solve the problem. You can increase the refresh rate by 10x, let's say. You get rid of all the errors. Actually, 7x is the point. But now you're expending more energy. You can add a lot of error correcting codes. You're expending more energy as well as area. So think of reliability and energy as two sides of the same coin. That's almost always true, actually. Latency and bandwidth, those are key things, especially if you have data-intensive applications. Reducing waste, we may talk about it at some point when we talk about heterogeneous memories. We have a lecture coming up on heterogeneity. So there's a lot of waste that's happening in terms of capacity and bandwidth and latency in memory. And we may get to that. And one of the things that, one of the emerging trends in memory research today is enabling computation close to data. Can we do more on the memory side to actually overcome some of these bottlenecks? And there are some technologies that are out there, actually, that can potentially enable this. You guys have heard of 3D stacking. In the 3D stack memory technologies, you have memory, and underneath, you have a controller. And these are connected via high bandwidth connections called TruthSilicon vias. Now the controller can have very high bandwidth access to memory. If you can actually put computation in that controller that's separate from the processor, that's far away from the processor still, now that controller can operate on that huge amount of bandwidth, huge amount of data that comes to it. Now if you can do that, you can actually reduce a lot of the energy. So this 3D stacking can enable a lot of new models of computation. So it's good for you to think about these things. And these already exist, actually, 3D stacking technologies. A hybrid memory cube from Micron is one example. High bandwidth memory from multiple companies. AMD's latest GPUs actually use high bandwidth memory, which has a controller, a 3D stack controller on their DRAM. And there may be more coming up. NVIDIA, I believe, is going to use high bandwidth memory also. OK. So if you want to learn more, there are some references in these slides. So you can, if you would like to learn more, you can go through some of these references. Not all of them, it's going to be a lot. And if you're taking 740, you're going through some of these references anyway. Let me give you the other solution direction very quickly, and then we'll go into a little bit more detail on how DRAM operates internally. This is still to motivate you, because there's a lot more interesting things going on in memory. The second solution direction is, there may be some emerging memory technology that's much better than DRAM, right? If we can somehow figure this out, we can enable it at the system level. And one example, there's been actually a lot of research recently on resistive memory technologies. These are fundamentally different from DRAM, and we'll talk about them. One example is phase change memory. They're fundamentally different because they're not charge-based. Charge-based memories always have the issue, as you reduce the charge storage unit, you have very few electrons, and electrons have problems because they can be perturbed easily, and they escape. The reliability, retention, they're both reliability problems in the end. Whereas if you're not reliant on electrons, if you're reliant on something else, maybe you're more scalable. Phase change memory is one example of that, and we'll talk a lot more about that. At the same time, ITRS said DRAM is hard to scale below 35 nanometers. They also said phase change memory is expected to scale to 9 nanometers, and this number is much lower now. And it's also expected to be less than the DRAM, but we can talk about that later. So the problem is these emerging technologies, they operate fundamentally differently, but they have other shortcomings. For example, in phase change memory, latencies are a problem, energy is a problem. Even though you don't need to refresh it because it's non-volatile, when you access it, the energy is high. So the key question is, can can they be somehow enabled to replace, augment, or surpass DRAM? And that's exactly what some of the companies are trying to do also right now, like the Intel Micron announcement on 3D XPoint. Can it actually replace DRAM, or can it augment DRAM somehow, such that your memory space is much larger? Right? We'll talk about that in the next lecture. Not that particular technology, but emerging technologies in general. And the third solution direction, which is again happening today, you guys are living in a really exciting time, actually, in terms of main memory. It's not just DRAM and DRAM scales, and you don't need to do anything about it, forget it, is something that looks like this. Maybe not exactly like this, but something hybrid. Basically, people have sought universal memories that are good at everything. Every metric that you can imagine, that universal memory is green. Now, unfortunately, that doesn't seem to exist. That's why we have memory hierarchy. Well, that may be why we'll have hybrid memory systems that look like this, right? You actually have some memory that's green at some metrics, that's red at some other metrics, and some other technology that's green at some metrics and red at some yet other metrics. And you put them together in your system and design the hardware and the software to manage data allocation and movement to achieve the best, to exercise the greens as much as possible while avoiding the reds as much as possible. And in a sense, this is already happening. If you think about it, if you have, for example, high bandwidth memory over here, HBM-like memory, and more commodity DRAM, now you have two different technologies. HBM is fast, high bandwidth, high energy, low latency, low capacity, because it's 3D stacked and you cannot put a whole lot over there. But commodity DRAM, low bandwidth, high latency, high capacity, and low energy compared to HBM. Now you have a different trade-off, right? Depending on what you want from your data access, you can place the data accordingly and scale the entire memory system without relying on a single technology scaling. This is a very promising direction that's also happening. Okay. And I'll give you one example very quickly based on what I've discussed earlier, embracing it, right? So if you have actually application level tolerance, and if you have different kinds of data in your application, some of it is actually, if you get a memory bit error, you don't care, right? There's a pixel that goes wrong. Oh, that's okay maybe, right? But then some other parts of your program, you have pointers, indices to your database. And if you get a bit error, you get a completely incorrect answer or your program crashes. Those are more vulnerable. If you can somehow classify your data based on the error vulnerability to memory errors, maybe you can design a hybrid memory system that can take advantage of it, right? Vulnerable data goes to reliable memory. Tolerant data goes to low-cost memory. And this way, this is called heterogeneous reliable memory, you can actually enable many different optimizations, system-level optimizations. And one of the things that some of my students did, basically, Yishin, one of my students, looked at Microsoft web search workload. And he's actually shown that you can reduce the hardware cost significantly by eliminating error-correcting codes from memory. So if you look at data centers today, Microsoft, Google, Amazon, most of the data centers use error correcting codes in memory. Not inside the DRAM, but you know the memory modules. You can have extra chip that's dedicated to store error correcting codes. We'll look at the memory module in a little bit. But that adds cost, because now you have an extra chip just dedicated for error correction codes, right? Now, data center companies don't like this. They want to reduce that. If you can actually have some of your memory low cost without the error correcting codes, you can reduce the hardware cost while achieving good availability because you can tolerate those errors at the application level if you do your data partitioning intelligently. So that's the idea. I think going forward, thinking about these ways, like hybrid ways of memory, is very interesting. So at some point, we'll talk about this issue. So I'll foreshadow it very quickly before we go into the detail of the DRAM hierarchy. But basically, this is an orthogonal issue. Regardless of what you build your main memory with, DRAM, phase change memory, emerging technology, hybrid memory, doesn't matter. If it's a shared resource across different cores, you have the problem of interference. These cores interfere with each other when they access the shared main memory. And if you don't control this interference somehow, you run into performance problems. So one core, for example, can occupy the entire cache or can occupy the memory controller, such that the other core gets denied access. And this is a very fundamental problem. Whenever you have a shared resource, if that shared resource is not controlled fairly across different agents that are accessing that shared resource, you have this interference problem. As a result, you can be unfair. You can starve some cores. You can have low performance. Because think about it. You design a 1,000-core system. But your memory controller prioritizes this application over and over because it has very good locality and floods the memory system. Now you have all those 999 cores starving, which means that you have low performance as well as low fairness, right? So that's a problem. So you can have an uncontrollable, unpredictable, and vulnerable system. So at some point, we'll talk about quality of, the solution is designing the memory system to be quality of service aware. So actually, if you look at the memory controller inside these chips, they have some quality of service mechanisms to ensure, because if you look at the system over here, you have a lot of different accelerators. You have the CPU, GPU, and a lot of different accelerators, and they all share the memory controller. And this memory controller needs to service them fairly such that they all can make progress and the system can make progress. Now, you can always question how good it is in terms of fairness, but you need to have some kind of fairness mechanism. So you need to have some quality of service, which means that you need to design the hardware to provide some fairness substrate. And at some point, we'll talk about this. And the software to design, configure the resources somehow to actually satisfy different quality of service goals. Yes?
Are there any follow-ups on the work you mentioned before, DSM? Are there any follow-ups on the work you mentioned before?
Oh, the heterogeneous reliability memory, not this particular? So that's a good question. I think there are. We can talk about it, yeah. But one thing people have proposed is, for example, changing the refresh rate to change the reliability of memory. Some part of your memory has very low refresh rate. As a result, you get errors. Some other part of your memory has very high refresh rate. You don't get errors. People have looked at constructing it differently. OK, let me pop the stack. Basically, you can design the software to actually provide different quality of service goals. Because if you think about it, if you're designing a general purpose system, you don't want to bake in a quality of service goal into the hardware, right? You want the memory controller to be flexible enough such that it can somehow prioritize this application, sometimes prioritize this application that you care about, sometimes deprioritize that particular application, sometimes prioritize the GPU, sometimes not prioritize the GPU, depending on what the user wants. So you want flexible mechanisms that the software can configure. And this is happening, actually. If you looked at a recent Intel Haswell announcement, Intel Haswell actually incorporates quality of service mechanism into its cache. You can actually do partitioning in the cache in a manner that's controlled by the software. That didn't happen before. This is one of the first processors in the general purpose domain, at least, that provide that kind of software configurable partitioning mechanisms. But at some point, we'll talk about quality of service over memory systems can provide predictable performance and higher efficiency. And why is this problem becoming even more interesting? Because all systems are looking like this going forward. Basically, systems are becoming very complex. You have CPUs, GPUs, accelerators, and these are sharing resources, some resources, and other parts of the system are sharing other resources. And you have these different controllers. Now, the key question is, how do you allocate the resource to these heterogeneous agents to mitigate the interference that's happening and provide predictable performance? That's something we will talk about at some point. So I'll skip this slide, but you can take a look at it. How do you provide strong memory service guarantees is becoming an even more important problem. And I'll motivate you a little bit. Basically, if you have a data center, let's say, today, what a lot of the data center systems do not do is they don't put multiple applications together on the same node, because they don't know how these different applications will interfere with each other in the memory system. As a result, you have this low utilization in many data centers because, oh, this node is dedicated to running Gmail, for example, only. And you're not supposed to put some other application that has a service level agreement. Well, if you had a mechanism that can provide predictable performance to the different applications by partitioning the cache and the memory controller, now you can consolidate more applications together, hopefully while satisfying the requirements of the applications. So that's why this is becoming an important problem going forward. But I'm going to skip this slide. You can take a look at it in more detail. Any questions so far? This was all overview of the memory system. Let's talk about some fundamentals, how we can design the memory system. OK, unless there are questions. OK, let me move on. So we're going to talk about main memory. And I've already talked about this, so I'm going to skip this. Basically, this has the same point. This is one example of a really old system. This is the AMD Barcelona system, actually. At that point, the cores were actually a much larger part, but they're shrinking comparatively to the other parts of the memory system. So ideally, it's always good to, when you're designing a system, it's always good to think about what are the ideal things that I want from the system. An ideal memory has these characteristics, right? You want zero access time, ideally, zero latency. infinite capacity, zero cost, and infinite bandwidth. Now, clearly, you cannot get all of this, right? Why can you not get all of this? Because these requirements oppose each other in reality, right? If you want bigger, it has to be slower, unfortunately. If you want faster, well, unfortunately, it's more expensive. Well, that violates the zero cost and fast at the same time, right? And higher bandwidth is also more expensive because you need to add more banks, for example, into the system. And we'll talk about this. So let's talk about these memory technologies. So memory technology actually affects the cost of memory significantly. And let's take a look at why by focusing on two technologies to begin with. DRAM technology, we've already covered this, so I'm going to go over this really quickly. Basically, you have this capacitor, and you need an access transistor to access it. And access transistor enables the charge sharing between the capacitor and the bit line, and bit line needs to be pre-charged such that you can sense the perturbation on that bit line using a sense amplifier at the bottom, right? Which I don't show over here. One issue with this technology is capacitor leaks through the RC path, of course, right? Which means that DRAM cell loses charge over time, which means that you need to refresh it. And this is something that you have in DRAM that you don't have in phase change memory, for example, some other resistive technologies. And you can take a look at this paper for the details of refresh. But this technology actually can be made really small. If you look at it, you just need a capacitor and an access transistor. Now contrast this with SRAM. SRAM is static random access memory. Basically, you have two cross-coupled inverters to store a single bit. Before, we just had the capacitor. So you need four transistors for storage. That's already four times the access transistor, let's say. And then you need two more transistors for access. These are the access transistors. So it's clear this is the 6T, six transistor SRAM cell. This is clearly much larger because capacitors, you can actually dig deeper and you can make the DRAM cell really small. Okay, so it's always good to think about the different technologies. So this is more costly. Phase change memory, this is an aside, this is just a teaser for the next lecture. Basically, you have this phase change material, chalcogenide glass, that exists in two states, amorphous and crystalline. And now you can actually switch between these two states reliably. And one state can encode 0, and the other state can encode 1. And one state has high electrical resistivity, and the other state has low electrical resistivity. And we'll talk about this technology later on. So don't constrain yourself to a single technology in main memory. You guys have heard about the memory bank before, right? Do we need to cover it? I guess very quickly, memory bank is a very fundamental concept to any type of memory. If you want to construct some memory, you start with a bank structure. Basically, the problem is if you want to have a single array of memory, let's say a two-dimensional array, if you want to access that, and all of your memory is that single array, that access is really slow, right? Now your interconnect is very long. And not only slow, but while you're accessing that single monolithic array, you cannot do another access. So having chopping up that monolithic array to many arrays called banks enables both lower latency as well as higher parallelism. And that's the goal of the bank, basically. Reduce the latency of memory array access and enable multiple accesses in parallel. So whenever someone asks you, why do you have banks? Well, it's lower latency and higher parallelism than a single monolithic array, right? This sometimes happens to be a good question, actually, in interviews, for example. Some of you are coming from the TOC. So the idea is to divide the array into multiple banks that can be accessed independently or mostly independently. And hopefully, you covered this in your previous architecture course. So an issue that always exists in any kind of bank memory or any kind of partitioned memory is how do you map the data to different banks? Or how do you map the data to different memory modules? And we'll get back to this, actually, at some point. So this is an example of a bank over here. It's basically a two-dimensional storage array. Think about this as two-dimensional array of cells. And you see the row over here. You have the row decoder. You have the column decoder. All memory at some level looks like this, actually. And you can or may or may not have a register over here, depending on what memory you're looking at. And this is the read access sequence. Basically, you need to decode the row address, which drives the word line over here. Remember the activate? That's basically the activate. You drive the word line. And then you sense selected bits drive the bit lines. You read the entire row in general. And then you amplify the data using a sense amplifier. And then if you want to access only a byte out of that, let's say, 4 kilobyte row, you need to mux it out using the column address. So you have a column decoder over here. And then to prepare the array for the next access, you need to precharge the bit lines. Precharging basically sets the voltage of the bit line to a known value that you can perturb reliably. Right. Does that make sense? Okay, so you should read do the reading so to see how a precharge operates. Okay. So why do we have memory hierarchy? Everything operates the same way, right? We have the banks, but the technologies can be different. We want both fast and large at the same time, right? We're greedy in the end. We want our memory to be fast and large. The problem is we cannot achieve both with a single level of memory. That's exactly why we have the memory hierarchy. Have multiple levels of storage that progressively become bigger and slower as the levels become farther away from the processor. And hopefully, manage this data such that you ensure most of the data is kept close to the processor, right? At least when you need to access it. That's the idea of the memory hierarchy. And you've seen this, hopefully, right? Caching is really a very fundamental idea that's been very successful over the years. I'm going to talk about that in a little bit. But basically, the fundamental trade-off is fast memory is slow, large memory is slow. And as a result, you have this memory hierarchy. And you can think about how latency changes, cost changes, size changes, and bandwidth changes as you go from left to right over here. And register file is part of the memory hierarchy, by the way. Register file is managed by the compiler or the programmer. That's the fastest memory, highest bandwidth memory, and most costly memory. And in terms of size, it's the smallest memory, right? And then you can have a scratch pad in GPUs, for example. There's a scratch pad. You can have caches in addition to that. And you can have main memory, DRAM, which is a cache to the hard disk, right? If you have a virtual memory demand-based system. Okay, very quickly, who doesn't know about caching here? Everybody knows about caching, right? Okay, I'm going to blast through this, but I'll give you some references. Basically, the key idea of caching is to initially exploit temporal locality. Basically, if you accessed a location, you're going to access it again. It's very likely. And store this recently accessed data and automatically manage fast memory called a cache. And hope that data will be accessed again soon. That's the temporal locality principle. And this is what Maurice Wilks had in mind when he wrote the cache paper that has made caches famous. It's not the first paper on caches. There's actually an earlier paper that this paper references. OK, you can take a look at this paper. The second basic caching exploits, and I'm going to focus on this a little bit more, because caching is employed in all parts of the memory hierarchy, including DRAM, right? Main memory, well, it's caching actually blocks from the disk, for example. It's also doing other things, but one of its functions is to cache the blocks from the disk. Basically, the second part of what caches exploited, they exploit spatial locality. They store not only the address you access, the data at that location you access, but the data that's around it in memory, with the anticipation that you're going to access that data in close proximity to each other. That's called the spatial locality. And how do you do that? Basically, you can think about how the cache operates. Okay. And this paper, if you want to look at the fundamentals, this is the first paper that discussed the spatial locality aspects of caching. IBM 36085 implemented a cache with 64-byte blocks. It's very interesting that we still have caches with 64-byte blocks, except IBM actually has much bigger blocks today because their workloads tend to have a lot of spatial locality. But you can take a look at this paper. Very briefly, manual versus automatic management. And this becomes interesting because we've discussed the hybrid memory idea earlier, right? If you're embracing this unreliability, who manages the memory now? Well, unreliability is a characteristic of the data. Who knows the characteristic of the data? Well, programmer probably has a good idea of whether or not the data is vulnerable, right? Maybe that memory you need to manage manually, right? So in a manual management memory, programmer manages the data movements. But it's usually too painful for the programmer for substantial programs. Right? Well, going forward, this may need to change. But okay, this is still done in some embedded processors, on-chip scratchpad memory. Actually, GPUs have scratchpad memories that where the programmer manages. Programmer says, oh, this memory location should be here. And that makes GPUs a little bit painful to manage also, one of the reasons. On the other hand, automatic management, hardware manages data movement across the levels transparently to the programmer. If you can do this well, programmer's life is easy. Everybody's happy, right? This is actually a good abstraction. If you can do this well, that's the key question. Can the hardware or the system automatically do this well? basically one simple heuristic many people have used over the many systems have used is keep most recently used items in the cache. This is the least recently used policy, right? Evict the least recently used data. Now that turns out it's not the best policy, and we may discuss that later. The good news is the average programmer doesn't need to know about this automatic management. If you want to write a correct program, you don't need to know how big the cache is and how it works, right? That's nice. The problem is if you want to actually take advantage of the best performance of your system, automatic management usually doesn't do as well as manual program rate management. Of course, the programmer needs to be an expert in that case, right? That's a very fundamental trade-off between programmer and architect or the system designer. Okay. So automatic management in memory hierarchy, this is actually one of the first papers in caching, Morris Wilkes. It's a beautiful paper. If you have time, you should definitely read it. It's only 2.5 pages. But basically, it talks about automatic management. And I'm not going to go over this because we don't have time, but it talks about automatically accumulating to itself words. That's the slave memory. It was called a slave memory in this paper. It's essentially a cache. Okay, so this is a modern memory hierarchy. You can read through this. Basically, we have levels and levels of caching. And you can see that DRAM is a cache that's managed by the virtual memory demand paging subsystem over here. And you can see different boundaries in this picture. The compiler or the programmer manages the register file. This part is usually automatically managed, although you can have scratch pads over here. That changes the boundary a little bit. And then you have the system level management over here. Any questions? Hopefully this is basics that's getting everyone into the same level. OK, so let's talk about the DRAM subsystem. This may be a little bit new to many of you. How many of you have covered DRAM in your previous undergraduate course? Yeah? Some? OK. Not everyone, though. That's good. So I'll go through two versions of this. Basically, I'll go through top-down and bottom-up. Basically, DRAM system has levels and levels. You can think about rows and columns, and then you construct a bank, and then chip, and then rank, and then dim, and then channel. So let's start with the lower level first. Basically, we talk about a bank, right? A bank is really a two-dimensional array of cells. It consists of rows and columns. A DRAM row, unfortunately, is called a DRAM page. So if you read the DRAM literature, you'll see the DRAM page. I call it unfortunately because you have the virtual pages also. These don't have to be the same. And sense amplifiers are also called the row buffer. So each address you present to the DRAM system from the memory controller is a row-column pair. And most DRAM today is page mode DRAM. What do I mean by this? Basically, you have this row buffer. And if you're accessing that row buffer, you actually get a row hit. And that access is actually faster. Initially, there's nothing in that row buffer. You access a closed row. You need to activate the row, bring the data into the row buffer. And then you can issue a read-write command to the DRAM chip, which brings some data, the column, from the row buffer outside. And then if you want to access another row, you need to use a precharge command to close the row and prepare the bank for the next access. Now, if you already have some row in the row buffer, and if you need to access it again, you just need to send the read-write command. There's no need for the activate command. So that's the nice thing about page mode DRAM, because you have this page or row inside the row buffer that you can keep accessing, which means that memory controllers can be designed to take advantage of this locality in the row buffer, right? If you already brought some row into the row buffer, and if you have requests in the memory controller that need to access it, well, the memory controller can reorder the request such that you keep hitting in the row buffer. Make sense? That takes advantage of the row buffer locality. So this is my cartoonish drawing of the DRAM bank. But this is very similar to what we've seen before. This is the two-dimensional array. And I put some numbers over here so that you can study it on your own. But basically, you have this row address that can be lashed. And then you activate it. And then you have this column address that can be lashed. Once you have the row in the row buffer, you send the column address, and also send the command, read or write. If it's a read, basically, the memory controller muxes out the data. The DRAM chip muxes out the data out of the row buffer and sends it out. Basically, this is the chip boundary, DRAM chip boundary. You get the address, which could be a row address or a column address. And in modern DRAM, you don't send the entire address. You send the row address with the activate command and column address with the read or write command. Now, what this enables is to have fewer pins in the DRAM chip. Because you don't send, if you look at here, row address is 14 bits, column address is 10 bits. And you also need to specify the bank, right? you don't send, let's say, 30 bits at the same time. You send at most 14 bits, or actually 17 bits if you have the bank also. That reduces the pin count of the DRAM chip. And this is one of the big constraints, actually. Those pins are big. As a result, chips are usually pin limited, and that affects your cost significantly. As a result, these chips are designed to minimize the pin count. So let's take a look at this operation very, very quickly, because I already told you most of this. Basically, this is a row buffer. It's initially empty, and this is a DRAM bank. If you want to access row 0 and column 0, the memory controller sends an activate command to the row, because the row buffer is initially empty, which brings the data into the row buffer. And then the memory controller later sends a column address to the row, which and the DRAM chip muxes out the data and sends it back to the controller. So notice that the memory controller waits until the data comes to the row buffer. So there's a delay that's associated with that, which the memory controller knows. And the memory controller also needs to wait after it sends the read command to the column until the data arrives. So these timings are actually specified in the DRAM data sheets. Okay, so that's where the DRAM timings come from. Now, if the memory, let's say the processor wants to access row 0, column 1, the memory controller keeps track of the status of the rows. And the memory controller says, oh, row 0 is already in the row buffer, so I just need to send, this is a row buffer hit, I just need to send a column command and a read, a column address and a read command. And the DRAM chip sends column 1 back to the memory controller. And if the address is to row 0 and column 85, again, this is a row buffer hit. And the memory controller just needs to send a column address and get the data. Now, if the processor needs to access row 1, column 0, now there is a problem here, right? This is a row buffer conflict because we want row 1, whereas row 0 is open in the row buffer, which means that the memory controller needs to do something else. It basically precharges the bit lines, which basically disconnects the row from the sense amplifiers. And then it sends the row address 1, sends an activate command, which takes some time, brings the data into the row buffer. And then it sends the column address. And then the DRAM chip muxes out the column. So clearly, a row conflict access takes much longer, right? In fact, it's 2 to 3 times longer in modern DRAM chips. OK, so what's a DRAM chip? Any questions? This is fun, right? You can actually build any kind of memory with this. So what's a DRAM chip? Basically, a DRAM chip consists of multiple of these banks. And banks share the command address and data buses. 8 is a very common number today in terms of the number of banks. How many banks you can put? Well, that's a constraint. That depends on how reliably you can operate DRAM as a DRAM manufacturer, right? Because you may have a lot of loading on the shared buses if you put too many banks. That's why we don't have too many banks today, actually. And the chip itself has a narrow interface. You actually, and this is, again, you're literally limited by the pins. If you look at the outside circuitry of a DRAM chip, the I/O pads occupy a huge area. And you need to ensure that the signal integrity is maintained. That's one of the reasons why you actually have a huge area in the I/O pads. And adding more bits, such that you can get more bits out of the DRAM chip, is expensive, because you need to drive those pins outside. So most of the chips today provide you 4 bits or 16 bits. 16 bits are more expensive. You can actually see that. We've already discussed this, but changing the number of banks, size of the interface, whether or not command address and data bus are shared has significant impact on the DRAM system cost, which we're not going to go into. But just to give you an example, this is the high-level block diagram of a relatively old DRAM chip right now. It's 1 megabit DRAM chip. You can see that it has 8 banks over here and 8 different row decoders. And you can see that the row address is 14 bits over here. And you can see that there's a bank address that needs to be provided also to do the activation or to do the column access. And here you have the sense amplifiers. You have the column decoder here. And column address goes into that such that you can actually get the column that you want over here. And internally, there's actually prefetching that's employed. So you can actually get multiple columns. Instead of getting a single column, you actually get, in this case, I don't remember. You can look at this. But this circuitry, the messy circuitry over here, is really to drive the data out and in. And that's actually the pin cost that you have. I don't expect you to know all of this. This is just to give you a real world view of what I drew by hand earlier. Right. Narrow, how do we get a lot of data from the DRAM chip, from the DRAM system? Well, we put multiple chips together and operate them in parallel. That's what's called a rank. Think of this like a rank of soldiers, right? You want 64 bits of data, but a chip provides 8 bits of data. Well, why don't you put 8 of these chips together and send them the same command? They all respond with different data at the same time. That's the idea of a DRAM rank. This forms a wide interface. That's how we can get more data. That's why you have in your modules, in your dual inline memory module, for example, or memory module that you stick into your motherboard, you have 8 chips, right? If you have 8 chips, you probably have 8-bit interface to your chips. If you have 4 chips, you probably have 16-bit interface. A lot of the server chips actually have 16-bit interfaces. OK, we've already discussed this. Basically, all chips comprising a rank are controlled at the same time. They respond to a single command, just like soldiers again. That's one of the reasons why it's called a rank, right? You share address and command buses, but provide different data. And we've already discussed this. OK. And this is what it looks like, again, cartoonish. But this is exactly what it is. You have 8 DRAM chips. And if you want to have error-correcting codes, you have one more chip over here. That's what we've discussed earlier. And that chip basically has a signature of whatever is contained in the other chips. That's the error-correcting part. OK, this is another view of looking at the rank by focusing on the internal. So you have one chip over here, another chip, 7 chips, 8 chips over here. And this is how they're connected. You can study this. But what is the advantage of a rank? Basically, now there are two advantages, actually. First, you have wide interface, right? You can get more data. But also, you have high capacity now, right? By adding more chips, now you have more capacity inside this module, that more than what you could get in a single chip. And you can keep adding these, right? And also flexibility. Now, the memory controller doesn't need to deal with individual chips. Now you have flexibility. You can actually get 64 bits. You can deal with 64-bit entities instead of 8-bit or 4-bit or 16-bit entities, right? The memory controller says, oh, I just want 64 bits. You can design the memory controller that way. Now this is a double-edged sword, actually, which means that you cannot actually access data at the 8-bit granularity. Maybe you just want 8 bits. You don't want the entire 64 bits. Well, too bad. You're going to get the 64 bits from this interface, which means that you're going to waste power on that data bus. That's the disadvantage. Basically, that's the granularity problem. Accesses cannot be smaller than the interface width. And this is actually a big problem today in energy wastage of main memory. Let me make you question a little bit some of the things. So we've discussed this row, right? This row is huge. Let's say 4 kilobytes or 8 kilobytes. If you're accessing only 8 bits, do you really need to activate the entire row? That's actually a lot of energy. You activate the entire row, you get 8 kilobytes, and then you get 64 bits out of it on this extremely energy inefficient interconnect between the processor and memory. So you're really wasting a lot of energy just to access 8 bits. If you don't have any locality, that's what you get today. So think about it a little bit. Now, there's a good reason why we have rows and columns, right? You actually want to have a rectangular structure to minimize your cost, such that you can cut out chips. Most number of chips from your wafer, right? That actually has a lot of effect on your yield as well. So think about why that row exists. You don't really want a narrow row. But think about the implications of this on the energy problem that we have today. OK, so if you want more capacity, what do? Well, add more DIMMs. And this is sorry about this picture. This is an interesting interconnect over here. But you can interconnect these DIMMs somehow, right? And this enables even higher capacity. Now, the memory controller controls not only a single DIMM, but let's say 4 DIMMs. And they're interconnected somehow. The downside is now these interconnect can have high complexity and high energy. Right? Remember, these are interconnects on your motherboard. Right? That's one of the, if you have 3D stacking, you can actually stack these different, what I call DIMMs over here, together potentially, right? And that interconnect energy goes down significantly. Now, you may run into other problems because you're stacking chips together and maybe connecting them with a very high bandwidth through silicon vias, you may actually run into thermal issues, right? Especially if you have controllers in between. But this is how we get high capacity in memory. Any questions? It's fun, right? Now we're building bigger systems. So this interconnect becomes interesting, actually. There was this proposal a long time ago that Intel advocated called fully buffered DIMM. And they wanted high capacity in the interconnect by adding many, many DIMMs together. And the way the interconnect was designed, it was a daisy chain. So you had this DIMM, another dim, another dim, another dim. And it was a daisy chain all the way to the farthest away dim. So you have very asymmetric latencies. If the memory controller needed to access data from here, that took a long time. So that never took off, the fully buffered dim, because one of the reasons was latency, but there are many other reasons also. So think about the complexity of the interconnect. We'll have a lecture on interconnect later. But these things are actually coupled with each other. OK. So channels. Basically, now we've covered the dims. You can have multiple dims. What is a channel? Basically, a channel is really what controls this set of dims. Right? It's a 64-bit channel in this case. Memory controller interfaces to that channel. And you can have independent channels. In this case, you have two memory controllers that are acting independently. You have a memory controller for this channel and a totally different memory controller for this channel. You can also have dependent or lockstep channels. You can have one memory controller with a wide interface. I didn't show it over here, but this is very similar to a DIMM, but you can have two DIMMs together and connect them to the same memory controller. Now it looks like a wider interface, if you want wider than 64 bits, for example. That's how you get it. And OK, let's construct everything right now. So this is a generalized memory structure. We've started with the columns and rows. A cache line is a number of columns over here. And a bank is two-dimensional array of columns of rows. And then you have multiple banks in a DRAM chip. And a DRAM chip, you have multiple DRAM chips in the rank. And then you have multiple ranks or multiple DIMMs that are connected to the channel. So this is the five-dimensional structure of modern DRAM, if you will. And if you have, think about 3D stacking, if you want to stack, you can actually stack these different layers. And there are multiple different ways of stacking. You can actually stack banks on top of each other, or you can stack like these DIMM-like ranks on top of each other. But we're not going to go into that right now. If we talk about emerging technologies, maybe we'll get to it. This is another way of looking at it. I'm going to skip this. But you can look at the reference papers for more detail.
Yes? Multi-core, you have different processors. For the Sierra DRAM, you have different processors. So it's the bus, loop controller, and DRAM below.
So this is the memory controller. You have the caches over here. So you can think about this. This memory controller, actually, here's the processor, for example. Processor can have multiple memory controllers. And you have the caches over here. Cache coherence is actually handled over here. So buses, this is the bus that you're talking about, I think. That's the bus between memory and the processor. It didn't used to be that way in the past. So with VLSI, with high-density integration, with Moore's law, memory controller got sucked into the processor chip. This was not the case if you're in 2000. If you think about FSB, front-side bus, for example, Intel had the front-side bus. You basically had the front-side bus controller that connected to another chip. That was a memory controller chip that connected to the DRAM chip. But with integration, memory controller got sucked into the processor chip, which reduced a lot of latency, enabled high bandwidth. And AMD was actually the first general-purpose company to put the memory controller on the same chip as the processors. Now that gives you more context, I think, right?
No, all the traditional courses we have for computer architectures, we're taking MSI protocols and so on. So
yeah.
It would be cache, buses, and
exactly. It's cache, memory controller, and then the bus. And we'll talk about coherence also. Well, there's a lecture coming. OK, any questions? Yeah. Yeah, certainly. So a single memory controller, so if the DIMMs are dependent on each other, let's say you get 64 bits from this DIMM, the next 64 bits from this DIMM, a single memory controller can easily control these two DIMMs. You can think of it as an extended rank. Right? Two DIMMs are operated as a single rank.
But that doesn't qualify them as separate channels.
They're still separate channels because you need separate pins, right? But they're dependent channels. So the pins are still expensive. But you cannot control them independently. Now, there are advantages of doing this. The advantage is you get a wider interface with a single memory controller. OK. But in most of today's systems, a memory controller controls a single channel. And you can independently operate those channels, those memory controllers. OK, let's take a look at the top-down really quickly. So what happens if you want to access a cache line, basically? This is the DRAM subsystem. You have these memory channels. And the DIMMs that we've discussed earlier. If you look at a DIMM, basically you can have the front of the DIMM and the back of the DIMM. This is a rank. I'm going to go through this relatively quickly because I've already covered a lot of this. Basically, you can have a rank 0 and rank 1, and they actually share some of the buses over here. So you cannot access them independently. And this is the rank. You have multiple chips that are responding to the same command with different pieces of data. And if you break down the chip, this is what it looks like, basically multiple banks that share the address command buses and the data bus that's going off the chip. But you can actually access them in a pipeline manner. You can activate one bank, and then you can activate another. That's how you get bank level parallelism, right? And if you look at a bank internally, it looks like a two-dimensional array of cells. Basically, we've gone from top down right now. Now, how do we actually access an entire cache block? Let's say you want to access the 64-byte cache block over here. Assume that it's mapped to this rank 0 and dim 0. Basically, what you do, and the interface is 64 bits. So we want 64 bytes. The interface is 64 bits. Well, what do you do? Basically, if you want to get the first 64 bits, it's at row 0, column 0. You access that. If you want to get the next 64 bits, which is 8 bytes, by the way, it's row 0, column 1. Next one, row 0, column 2, dot, dot, dot. So you really need to do 8 I/O cycles, 8 accesses to transfer the data. Right. Now, the good thing is in page mode DRAM, usually what you have is burst mode today. You can actually operate DRAM in burst. So these accesses are not as costly. If you access column 0, the next access you can pipeline. Column 1 access you can pipeline such that you don't have a bubble in the data bus. You don't need to activate again. That's called the burst mode of DRAM. And that enables accesses to a long cache line. There, you can look it up. OK, so let's take a look at the latency components, basic latency components of DRAM operations. So it's actually very high latency if you think about it, right? First, you need to, if you want to do a load access from the CPU to the controller, you need to transfer that load. Assume that it's a cache miss, right? You don't hit in the cache. And then controller, you have some latency. Because the controller is not busy. If there are other cores that are accessing, maybe you have queuing that's happening and scheduling delay. Now the access, eventually access is converted to basic commands. And assume that the controller selects this command. Now it needs to transfer to DRAM that command. Now you incur DRAM bank latency. And DRAM bank latency is dependent on whether you hit in the row buffer, whether the row buffer is open, whether you get a conflict. Right? And we've discussed this already. It could be a simple column address strobe if the row is open. It's a column command. It could be row address strobe followed by a column address strobe. If the array is precharged, basically the row is closed and you're precharged, you don't need to issue a precharge. Or it could be the worst case. You need to issue a precharge, a row address strobe, activate, and a column address strobe, which is read and write. I'm giving you terminology at the same time because you will see some of this in maybe in some of your courses you've seen row address strobe and column address strobe also. So that's the bank latency. Bank latency occupies some time. But that's not the only part of latency. Later, you need to transfer that data from the DRAM to the controller. This is the bus latency. That occupies some time. That's the interconnect latency between the DRAM and memory. And eventually, you need to transfer from the controller all the way back to the CPU. That's the on-chip interconnect latency. So that round-trip latency actually consumes a lot of time. In fact, to give you a data point, in Xbox 360, that latency was about 650 cycles, processor cycles. That's a long latency, right? If you think about an ad being one cycle, 650 cycles, you can do 650 ads in that time, right? OK, so multiple banks versus channels. Do we add more banks or do you have more channels? Well, that's actually not necessarily in your control, but multiple banks, the goal of both is to enable concurrent accesses, right? In multiple banks, you pipeline the accesses. In multiple independent channels, it's even better because now you have separate data buses, right? In multiple banks, you don't have the separate data bus. If you remember the figure, you can access one bank, and you can pipeline the access to the next bank. So you can still keep the data bus busy, but you cannot access two banks concurrently because they share the interface out of the DRAM chip. But independent channels give you increased bus bandwidth. That's how you can actually increase the bandwidth. But now you have your bottleneck by the number of pins that you have on the chip. So enabling more concurrency requires reducing the bank conflicts that you have and the channel conflicts that you have. Even if you have, let's say, 8 banks, if two of your accesses go at the same time to the same bank, you have a bank conflict, right? They need to be serialized. That's true for the channels also. And this can happen. If your data is not mapped well, or if you're unlucky, two accesses can go to the same bank and send channels. And this is actually a big problem. You may provide good bandwidth to your memory system, but you may still be limited by the bank and channel conflicts because your data is not mapped well. And this has been a big problem in supercomputers for a long time. In fact, a lot of the techniques to reduce bank conflicts and channel conflicts were developed in the context of single instruction multiple data processors in the 1980s, 1990s. And we'll talk about that when we get to the GPUs. But one of the issues was if your stride in memory was not nice, you would keep accessing the same bank over and over. And as a result, even though you had 16 banks, if your stride is 16, you would always bang on the same bank, and your main memory bandwidth, the sustained bandwidth, would be, I guess, 1/16 of what you would otherwise sustain, 1/16 of your peak bandwidth, right? So this is actually a big problem. So how do you select or randomize the bank channel indices and address is an important consideration. And usually, lower order bits have more entropy. They keep changing in the program because you allocate some memory. You don't actually stride with huge strides. Strides are actually smaller. As a result, these lower order bits are used to map the data. And also, you can use randomizing hash function. You can actually store different address bits. But we'll take a look at it in a little bit. So I'm going to skip this. So you guys hopefully you know how multiple banks help, right? This is just a cartoonish picture. If you had a single bank, this is what would happen, basically. You keep waiting for DRAM access. But if you have multiple banks, you can pipeline those accesses such that you get a data every cycle. Make sense? OK. Shout if you don't know this. OK, good. So how do you map the data? If you have a single channel, there are actually two ways of mapping data. And this is, again, an example that you can look at it on your own. You can interleave the rows. Consecutive rows in memory can be in consecutive banks. Or you can actually interleave the cache blocks. Consecutive cache blocks can be in consecutive banks. And these have different implications in terms of row buffer locality, for example, right? If you have consecutive rows in consecutive banks, row 0 is mapped to the same bank. And you may get really good row buffer locality in that bank. And then some other bank may be reserved for some other row that you keep accessing, right? Whereas if you do cache line interleaving, cache block interleaving, now a row is present in many banks, right? That cache block, the next cache block is over here. Now you can pipeline the accesses, but now you may not have very independent rows across different banks if you're streaming through memory. OK, you can think about this a little bit. OK. Basically, access to consecutive cache blocks are serviced in a pipeline manner in this case, whereas here, access to consecutive cache blocks can be serviced in parallel. And think about this also, this mapping we'll see in a little bit, but this row interleaving and cache block interleaving are two commonly used methods for mapping data. There may be other interleaving methods. You can, for example, say if you have 8 banks, the first 1/8 of my memory gets mapped to this bank, the second 1/8, the third 1/8. That's usually not a good method because you can actually get a lot of bank conflicts. The finer grain you get, the better you reduce the bank conflicts. Okay, so this is actually employed in some processors. DRAM controller, what it does is to minimize the possibility of bank conflicts, it adds some hashing function. Remember the hashing function we looked at in branch predictors, in the branch prediction lecture? And I told that, oh, it's used in cache. Well, it's used in memory controllers also. It's a very fundamental mechanism. You basically take some bits. You don't directly take 3 bits from the address and say, oh, this is my bank address. Oh, but you actually randomize those bits by XORing them with some other bits. And that distributes the addresses across banks in a more randomized fashion, such that the likelihood of 2 accesses going to the same bank reduces. And actually, this is a really nice paper by Bob Rao that was written in ISCA 1991. It's a very theoretical paper. It's called Pseudorandomly Interleaved Memory. He looked at this in the context of SIMD processors. How do you actually do the interleaving of memory, randomization of the addresses, mapping of the addresses to banks such that you minimize the bank conflicts? So if you want to, if you like Galois fields and math, you can take a look at this paper. But there are other things beyond Galois fields in that paper, the concepts. So let me give you an example of this mapping problem, because this is really fascinating, I think. And it's a very complex problem. Which bits do you select to choose the channel, row, bank, column? Well, you can choose the channel bit. Let's say you have 2 channels. You can choose a channel bit from the top, or somewhere in the middle, or somewhere lower. Now, which data gets mapped to different channels, and how much control you have in the mapping makes a difference, right, based on this mapping. For example, if you do this, you choose this bit, you're interleaving at the byte level. This byte goes to this channel. This next byte in memory goes to this channel. May not be a good idea. And I mean, you can have different techniques over here. And you can actually play fun games over here. So for example, one example is if you actually choose a cache block to go to this channel, if you do cache block interleaving across the channels, now the operating system cannot say this page goes to this channel, right? You actually eliminated that possibility. Because in the hardware, you chose to use a physical address bit that does cache block interleaving. There's no way the operating system can allocate a page to this channel, because that page actually gets distributed across channels. Whereas you may want to allocate a page to this channel and some other page to this channel, such that those two pages, those two applications, don't interfere with each other. Right? So if you do page interleaving or row interleaving, you can do that. So this mapping that you choose in hardware has a lot of implications on the software level also. Why? Well, it's exactly because of this. Basically, you have a virtual to physical mapping in the virtual memory system. And it looks like this. You have the virtual address, you have the page offset, and a virtual page number. In this case, it's 64 bits. And it maps to a physical address. Page offset doesn't change, but the virtual to physical, this physical frame number changes. And the operating system has a lot of influence over here. Now you have this, you can interpret, the memory controller interprets this physical address in a different way. Basically, it says, oh, these are the bank bits. These are the column bits. Now, if the bank bits are actually in this portion that's changing, or that can be controlled by the virtual to physical translation, now the operating system has control over which bank to allocate a virtual page's physical frame from, right? Whereas if you chose the bank bits from here, the operating system has no control because these bits do not change in the translation, right? That's what I mentioned earlier. So the operating system actually can influence where an address maps to in DRAM, if you can somehow figure this mapping out. That mapping is not exposed in many systems today to the operating system, but you can actually write a program that reverse engineers that mapping, and people have done that. Okay, so this actually, operating system, based on this, it can actually perform page coloring. Page coloring is basically you have different colors assigned to different bank numbers, let's say. So 000 is one color, for example. And it can say this application can be given only these colors, and this application can be given these colors. As a result, they go to different banks. That's nice, right? You can reduce the interference across applications. You can also minimize the bank conflicts. You can actually expose it to the compiler, and the compiler does the allocation if it has control over the system. And a lot of embedded systems, there is that control, actually. In embedded systems, you're running one program. Let's say you're designing an automotive controller. Automotive controller is probably very large, but let's say you're designing a brake system, and you actually know your program really well. You can allocate the data to different banks that way at the compiler level. Maybe you don't have an operating system over there, right? OK, you can actually do many, many things. Think about this aspect of the memory system. So the virtual memory actually influences where the data gets mapped to. So there's a lot more to talk about on reducing bank conflicts, but I'm going to refer you to this paper. This actually talks about the fact that whatever I told you, there's another level to it. So even a bank is not the smallest level in the memory system. Because it turns out this bank, let's say it has 32,000 rows, even that's really slow to access. Internally, even though logically it's exposed like this to the memory controller, internally it looks like this. Basically, you have many, many subarrays. In this case, I guess it's 16 subarrays over here, right? And internally, you really have many row buffers. And you can take a look at this paper for the internal organization of the bank. OK, any questions? OK, let's keep going. Let's learn a little bit more about DRAM. I guess I'll not take a break and leave you a little bit early then. Let's shoot for that. So refresh. Refresh is actually a critical component of DRAM in main memory, and you will need to deal with that. Or do you guys want a break? No? OK. I see no. So if you actually want to be overruled by no's, all right, let's keep going. Good. So refresh. The issue here is, as I discussed earlier, DRAM capacitor charge leaks over time, right? And the memory controller needs to refresh each row periodically to restore the charge. This means that you need to activate a row and precharge the row every n milliseconds. Today, n is 64 milliseconds. And that's actually reducing. At high temperatures, it's about 32 milliseconds. Imagine you design a 1 terabyte memory system. Imagine how many rows are there. You can do the calculation. You're refreshing every single row every 32 milliseconds if it's operating at high temperature. And you can actually, the biggest supercomputer today, I think it's still Tianhe 2 from China. I think it has about 1.2 petabyte memory. And if each row is 8 kilobytes, you actually easily have 2 to the 40 rows, almost 2 to the 40 rows in that system. That's a lot. And you're refreshing it every 64 milliseconds. So you can actually spend megawatts and megawatts of energy on refresh in a supercomputer like that, just to keep the data there. You're not even accessing it. So there are actually implications on performance. DRAM bank is unavailable while it's refreshed. There are different methods. We're not going to go into that. And it can actually have long pause times. If you actually refresh all rows at the same time in burst, every 64 milliseconds, the DRAM will be unavailable until that refresh ends. So there are two methods of doing DRAM refresh. One is burst refresh. All rows are refreshed immediately after one another. The other is distributed refresh. Each row is refreshed at a different time at regular intervals. Most of the DRAM controllers use distributed refresh today because it makes sense, right? So if you take a look at it, this is burst refresh. You wait until 64 milliseconds, and then you refresh entire memory. Now, it used to be like that in the past, and people figured out quickly that this has bad impact on quality of service. Your memory is unavailable for a while. Well, if you can distribute the refreshes, now you can actually have a much better quality of service. You don't have these long pause times when refresh triggers, because refresh is always happening, right, in a distributed way. But this is still a problem, actually. If you remember that paper, Samsung and Intel, they said refresh is one of the biggest problems. And if you talk to a DRAM designer today, what's causing you the biggest headache? They will probably tell you it's refresh. If I can get rid of refresh in DRAM, I can design a much better DRAM for you. Well, it's too bad. It's a very fundamental thing in the technology, right? It's charge-based memory. So can we reduce the number of refreshes? I'll ask this question. Why do we want to reduce the number of refreshes? Basically, refresh, actually, I didn't talk about this, but each refresh consumes energy also. So energy consumption is a big problem with a refresh. You get performance degradation. You get quality of service impact. And refresh rate actually limits density scaling, DRAM density scaling. I'm not going to talk about this. We've covered some of this in recitation in 740. But if you have interest in this in 640, you can take a look at this paper that talks about the refresh problem. And this is going to become a bigger issue in DRAM, because as you scale the size of the circuit, that access transistor becomes more leaky and the capacitor becomes less reliable. As a result, it becomes more difficult to maintain the charge in that cell. And also, there are also random effects that start appearing in DRAM, which makes it difficult to determine the retention time of a cell, which I'm not going to cover, but you can take a look at the papers. OK, let's talk about memory controllers a little bit, because you cannot avoid memory controllers if you're actually designing memory. And this is going to be a little bit general. Even though we're talking about DRAM, any type of memory requires a memory controller. Flash memory requires a memory controller. And in fact, do you guys think flash memory is non-volatile? It is non-volatile, right? It can keep data, at least for a while. At least you hope. Does that mean you don't need to refresh it? Yeah? Ideally, you don't want to refresh non-volatile memory, right? Because it can retain data. But it turns out, even flash memory requires a refresh today. So if we maybe at some point we'll talk about this. But what happens is, as you write to a flash memory cell, it becomes more leaky. And at some point, you're not able to write to it. But if you start refreshing it, now you eliminate that leakiness. As a result, you can actually keep the data in the cell for much longer. So in today's flash memory controllers, retention is a big issue. Almost all modern high-performance SSDs refresh flash after a while. Not initially. Initially, the cells are nice. They can leak. They don't leak. They can retain data for longer. But if you keep writing to it, at some point they lose their ability to retain data. And there are many mechanisms for this. There are tunneling mechanisms inside the floating gate. And I can point you to reference if you want. But you need to refresh that cell. So refresh is a fundamental problem in a lot of charge-based memories. Whenever you have charge, it starts escaping at some point. Keep that in mind for the next lecture. OK, let me go back to the memory controllers. Basically, long latency memories have similar characteristics that need to be controlled. So you need to design a memory controller. So in the following discussion, I'll use DRAM as an example. But Many scheduling and control issues are similar in the design of controllers for other types of memories, like phase change memory, like flash memory. Flash memory actually has a lot of issues, in fact, maybe harder issues, because it operates at a block level, and other emerging memory technologies. And these other technologies can place other demands on the controller. For example, we'll talk about the wear out issue in phase change memory in the next lecture. And flash has this problem also. If you keep writing to a cell, after some point, you cannot write to or read from that cell. The cell wears out. Basically, you cannot do anything to that cell. That's the wear out problem or endurance problem. To ensure that this happens in a nice way across the entire memory, what these controllers do, flash memory controllers do, is they do wear leveling. This is something that doesn't exist in DRAM, at least today. Right? Maybe in the future it may exist, think about it. But what they do wear leveling, and that's a controller's job. How do you do that wear leveling is an important problem, actually. So I'm not going to talk about that, but I'm going to talk about DRAM also. But DRAM also has different types. So let me give you the complexity of the controller design. DRAM has different types with different interfaces optimized for different purposes. You can have, and I'm not going to go into the details of these interfaces. This is something that, and some of it is actually really related to the standards, but you can have low power interfaces, you can have commodity interfaces, you can have high bandwidth interfaces, GDDR interfaces, you can have low latency interfaces, embedded DRAM, RL DRAM, reduced latency DRAM. You can have 3D stacked interfaces today. These are actually new types of memories that didn't exist in the past, high bandwidth memory, hybrid memory cube. They stack the controller and the memory together. And you can have many different types of interfaces. Now, underlying microarchitecture of the DRAM is fundamentally the same, actually. What I described to you, the row level operation, is fundamentally the same. And a flexible memory controller can support various DRAM types. And this complicates the memory controller now, right? What if you want to design a memory controller that can support all of these types? Well, it becomes difficult, actually. And especially if you want to upgrade your memory at some point, a new standard comes out. How do you upgrade your memory controller, right? Now, if you had a different chip in DRAM, the previous discussion can be helpful. In the past, you had this memory controller in a separate chip. Well, if you change your memory, you can actually change the chip in the chipset. Now you don't need to change your processor. But now memory controller is coupled with the processor, right? That's inside the processor in most systems. Well, do you actually upgrade your entire processor chip? OK, think about that. So this is an example. I would point you to this paper, which at some point we may cover. But basically, there's a lot of memory, different DRAM types that are coming up today. Let's talk about the functions of the DRAM controller. That gives you a little bit more in terms of the difficulty of designing these controllers. The first function is ensure correct operation. Basically, you need to ensure that DRAM is refreshed and the timing parameters are maintained, right? You need to service DRAM requests while obeying the timing parameters, timing constraints. So what are these timing constraints? Basically, a memory controller needs to keep track of the resource conflicts, right? Whether a bank is busy, a bus is busy, a channel is going to be busy, right? Because when you schedule a command, the channel is going to be busy later, right? Because the data will come back after some time. So you need to actually schedule in time these requests. And write-to-read delays, this is something we didn't talk about, but you cannot, there's some time for the bus to stabilize. After you do a write, if you want to do a read, it takes some time. There are some dead cycles on the bus. So this write-to-read scheduling becomes a difficult problem, especially once your write latencies are long. And also, while doing this, the memory controller needs to translate requests to DRAM command sequences. So basically, there are about 100 plus timing constraints that the DRAM controller needs to keep track of. On top of this, the DRAM controller needs to buffer and schedule requests for high performance and quality of service. And we briefly talked about this. It needs to do this row buffer management, right? And this is becoming more complex, especially if you want to provide quality of service to different applications. And on top of this, it may need to manage the power consumption and thermals in DRAM, right? DRAM chips have modes where they can be turned on and off. They can go into different power modes. And if you really care about a power-constrained environment, you may want to go into that mode. One mode, for example, is self-refresh mode. Only thing DRAM does is automatically refresh itself, and you cannot access DRAM. Now, that's a good mode to be in if you're idle most of the time, like in this, right? But it turns out it's difficult to get out of that mode. It takes some time. So you don't want to go into that mode very frequently, because if you are using this, now you're actually using memory, right? So how do you manage that? So all of this adds complexity to the DRAM controller. So where to place, I think I've covered this. So there are many trade-offs. I'll go through some of these trade-offs in the DRAM controller design. One trade-off is, where do you have the DRAM controller? In the chipset, as I've discussed, you have more flexibility to plug different DRAM types into the system if the DRAM controller has its own chip. And you have less power density in the CPU chip. But if you have on the CPU chip, you have reduced latency for main memory access. That's why a lot of the manufacturers have incorporated, sucked in the DRAM controller. But that may change, right, with the high bandwidth memory. So there's an interesting time that's coming up. Does the controller stay in the CPU chip, or does the controller go to the memory side? Or is there a controller on both sides? Now, what is the function of those different controllers, right? That becomes really interesting. And as the landscape of memory changes, some of the fundamentals may need to be re-examined. If you have it on the CPU chip, you have also higher bandwidth between the cores and the controller. Now, we can actually communicate more information. I'll give you an anecdote. So when the memory controller used to be on the chipset, a lot of the algorithms were not that sophisticated. So first come, first serve was a good algorithm, for example. And you didn't communicate the type of request. So if you want to say, oh, this is a prefetch request, well, you need an extra pin, or you need to somehow have a different interface. Well, that doesn't exist. That extra pin is costly. If your memory controller is on chip, you can actually easily communicate that to the memory controller from the core. The core can generate a prefetch request, and it can say another wire, right? On-chip wires are very cheap. Off-chip wires are expensive because you need a pin for that. So you can have higher bandwidth communication between the cores and the controller, which means that you can have more information. And there could be other different types of information. OK, so a modern DRAM controller looks like this. I'll actually give an example of this. Basically, it's usually a hierarchical controller. You get a memory request buffer. You have the request buffers for different banks. And you have different schedulers for different banks. And each scheduler selects a request that's ready, that satisfies the timing constraints. And then you have a bus scheduler, that's the second level, that picks out of this. And again, I'm not going to go into the detail, but let's take a look at some scheduling policies. The first one is first come, first serve, right? How do you actually, you have a bunch of requests coming from potentially different cores or potentially the same core. How do you schedule these requests? The first one is not a scheduling policy. It's basically service things as they come, right? In a sense, it's a scheduling policy, but it's not an intelligent scheduling policy. The second one is employed by many controllers that are single core based. It's called first ready, first come, first serve. Basically, it's a prioritization order. It prioritizes row hit requests over others. And all else being equal, it prioritizes older requests over others. Now, as we've discussed, this maximizes the row buffer hit rate, right? If the row buffer is open, prioritize the request that accesses that row buffer, right? It maximizes DRAM throughput. But actually, the scheduling is done at the command level, right? You have the column commands, read, write, and the activate precharge that we've discussed. So that's a smaller issue. But if you're designing memory controllers, you need to actually deal with these commands. So a scheduling policy is basically a prioritization order. And prioritization can be based on many things. And I'm going to give you some things, but I'm not going to go into the different policies. Request age is one of them, right? Oldest first, clearly. Row buffer hit miss status, clearly one of them. Request type is one of them. Read, write, prefetch. Modern memory controllers have to distinguish between read, write requests because you can drive the memory bus only in one mode. You can either do a write to the DRAM chip, or you can do reads. You cannot do both at the same time, which leads to an interesting trade-off. How do you schedule the writes versus reads? Modern memory controllers batch the writes such that they can do the writes in burst and get rid of those writes when the write buffer is almost close to full. And then they switch to the read mode. So they have this bipolar execution structure, if you will. They do reads and then writes and then reads and then writes and then reads and then writes. If the write latencies are longer, it may become difficult to manage that, right? Requester type is a load miss, store miss. How important is a requester? Request criticality, oldest miss in the core. How many instructions in the core are dependent on? These are some information that are difficult to take into account. Will it stall the processor? If you can somehow predict that, that would be useful. Interference cost to other cores. Increasingly, many controllers are actually taking that into account, especially those controllers that are designed for this kind of systems, where you have different kind of agents. CPUs and GPUs. You don't want to prioritize a GPU all the time because latency critical CPU can get delayed greatly. So you can imagine these different things. I'm not going to give you different policies. At some point, we will cover that actually. But let's talk about the row buffer management policies very quickly. because this is very fundamental to the operation of any memory, actually. One is open row, basically. And the idea here is you keep the row open after an access. And the anticipation is that you're going to reuse. You have spatial locality in the row, right? So if it's if the next access needs the same row, that's a row hit. That's great. The problem is if the next access needs a different row, now we have a row conflict. You actually have wasted energy and also reduced performance, perhaps. If you proactively close that row, the next access would take shorter, right? The second policy is closed row. You close the row after an access. And usually the policy is intelligent. You don't close it right away. You look at other requests in the request buffer. If there's no other request already in the request buffer that needs the same row, you close the row. That's the intelligent closed row policy. Now, if the next access needs a different row, this is good. You avoid a row conflict, right? Now, but if the next access needs the same row, you have the extra activate again for the same row. Now, that may be bad. Yes? Yes, exactly. That's the closed row. Assuming that there are no other requests in the request buffer already that need the same row. So you look at the request buffer. If there's no other request that needs it, you close the row. But the hope is that you don't have a lot of locality in the row. So it may make sense.
But
right.
Keeping the data in the row is not a waste because you've already fetched it.
Yeah. Well, there are two kinds of wastes. If the next access goes to that same row, now at that point in time, you need to precharge. Which means that precharge latency is on your critical path for the next access. Whereas if you had proactively closed that row, proactively precharged it, you would avoid that latency. So you can actually gain latency. And there is also a second thing. If you actually have precharged the row, precharged the array, you're wasting less power. It turns out when the array is not precharged, array is in active mode, it's always circulating this charge. As a result, you're wasting some power. It's not a whole lot, but you're still wasting power. OK. So there are adaptive policies, and actually a lot of modern memory controllers do adaptive policies. They predict whether or not the next access to the bank will be to the same row. And based on that, they decide whether they should do a closed row or open row policy. Because there are power implications on this also. There are some timeouts, for example, in some memory controllers. They say, after a while, I'll time out and close this row. OK, you can take a look at this tape. Basically, this table goes through different policies. It talks about the first access and the next access. And the commands that are needed for the next access if your policy is like that. I'm not going to go through this in detail. But I'll talk about power management a little bit. Basically, DRAM chips have power modes, maybe not as much as we like, but there are some power modes. Basically, the key idea is when you're not accessing a chip, power it down. Now, usually these power modes are at the rank level today because you cannot control individual chips, actually. So these are the power states. You have active, the highest power. All banks are idle, which means all banks are actually precharged. You have the power down state and the self-refresh. That's the low power state. The trade-off is state transitions incur latency during which the chip cannot be accessed. So that's the trade-off in power management. You may want to go into some mode, but now you go into a state transition where you cannot access the chip. Okay, I'm not going to go into the power, because this is an area, actually, there will be probably more power modes coming in future generation DRAMs, especially 3D stacked DRAM. But let's not go into that. But let me finish with the difficulty of DRAM control. I still have some more time. But this is a fascinating topic. And if you ever end up designing DRAM controllers in the industry, you'll appreciate that, how difficult it is. So we've discussed, you need to obey timing constraints for correctness. And there are many timing constraints, 50 plus that are important. But really, it's more than 100 plus. And I've given you some write to read, minimum number of cycles to wait before issuing a read command after a write command is issued. And there are many of these. In the next slide, I show some examples. On top of this, you need to keep track of many resources to prevent conflicts: channels, banks, ranks, data bus, address bus, row buffers. You need to handle DRAM refresh. You need to manage power consumption and optimize performance and quality of service by doing good scheduling. And reordering is actually not simple. How do you do that reordering? How do you do that in an application-aware manner? All of this add complexity to the DRAM controller. And these are some example timing constraints. And this is only, I think, 14 of these. And you can look at this paper. So one example over here is 4 activate windows. Basically, you can do 4 activates within time interval. You cannot do more than 4. Why? Because that's a power-related constraint. You can actually activate more than 4 banks within that time window, because otherwise you'll actually heat up the DRAM too much. And if you want to learn some of these other constraints, you can look at this paper for more DRM operation. But basically, my point is this design is actually becoming more difficult. And I was giving you the slides earlier. We have these different kinds of agents and different kinds of interference, hybrid memories. How do you design the memory controller? I'll finish with just one idea. This is more of a research idea. I'm not going to cover it in detail. But I think going forward, it's good to think about systems in different ways. But basically, it's difficult to optimize all these different constraints while maximizing performance, quality of service, and energy efficiency. Wouldn't it be nice if the DRAM controller automatically found a good scheduling policy on its own? Right? Today, the scheduling policy, the hardware designer needs to figure it out. Right? FRFCFS is a very simple scheduling policy, rope hit first. It doesn't cover a lot of these issues. It needs to handle the DRAM timing constraints, but clearly it doesn't handle a lot of the things. And that's the idea of self-optimizing DRAM controllers. So maybe in one slide, DRAM controllers are difficult to design. It's difficult for the human designer to design a policy. Well, why don't we design a memory controller that adapts its scheduling policy to workload behavior, usually machine learning? Now, this may be a stretch at this point in time. But going forward, as the systems become more complex, you guys may want to think about solutions like this. And the observation here was reinforcement learning actually maps nicely to memory controller. And you can actually treat the memory controller as a reinforcement learning agent that can dynamically and continuously learns and adapts its scheduling policy to the best possible policy. I'm going to refer you to the paper, but this is, I think, one of the, I don't want to call it a crazy idea, but it's a cool idea that can enable machine learning principles into the design of systems. And as systems become more complex, I think this may be a good direction to take in general. OK, I'll let you read the paper. But I'm happy to take questions. And in the meantime, I'll assign you these we will not cover. I'll give you the papers to read for the next lecture. So we'll cover emerging technologies in the next lecture. So this is the required reading assignment. And these are some of the recommended readings that I selected. Any questions before we part? Any thoughts? Hey.
Might I take 2 minutes of your students' time after questions?
Oh, OK. Yeah, we have a visitor from Samsung.
Yes.
So let's take the questions first.
Right.
No questions? OK, why don't you do the reading? And in the meantime, Eric.
Yes.
You want me to? Yeah, sure. Well,
I'm sorry.
You're
yes. I apologize to interrupt the lecture here.